Geographic information system and the related sciences like the remote sensing, photogrammetry. So what are the normal questions being asked in interview, Viva Voice, etc.? What is geocoding? So geocoding, before we start answering this, there is always a word geo along with various combination. The geo means earth. Geo is about our planet. So this is not that coding which we do in programming. This geocoding is the process of transforming a description of a location. It can be coordinates, address, coordinate means latitude, longitude, address or name of the place. So how to put all this information or any of this information to the location on the earth's surface. This is called as geocoding. You see an example here. So this is a map and you are placing or putting some name, and soon you enter the name. It takes you to a proper spatial location. It identifies that this is the location we are talking about. Geocoding is the process of converting an address into spatial data and associating the exact geographical coordinates for that address. Basically, Earth, everything, we have decided that everything will have a location. That is latitude, longitude. And what is the information, metadata, attribute? That is, at this location, whose house is this or which office is there? So you know the name. The main thing is it in 2D also, in 3D also. So in GIS, it is very helpful, mainly in mapping, mainly in the Google Maps, mainly in the various application, because the locations are numbers. For example, any point is uniquely identified by the latitude, longitude and the projection. For example, latitude, longitude has these number. Now these number, we are not very well, in a remembering way, we are very good in numbers. But if you say Walmart at say Silk Street or any other street, we know that, okay, we are talking about this. So the name is known to us. This is how we do or live our life, with names, not with numbers. So it is also called as a forward geocoding. What is georeferencing? Whenever this word comes, geo means earth. We are talking about earth. When we ask about reference, so referring to the earth, what you are referring to the earth? Location, photo, more information. Sometimes you send someone and you say that this is my reference letter. So when that guy goes to a job interview, you have given him the reference. So he gets the job because there is a reference. You are the reference. Similarly, in georeferencing, Earth is the reference. So why do we need this georeferencing? There is one more question I'm going to answer just now. But in geography, whatever we see is okay. But when we actually go for computation, when we go for software, when we go for actual computations, for example, aerial photographs are there. The say satellite images are there. But when this comes, it doesn't have that information of what exactly where this image is going to be placed. For example, in Google Earth or Google Maps or ArcGIS or any software, when you import this image, where it is going to fit, it has to go to the exact image. But when the photograph is taken, aerial photograph or satellite image, it doesn't have that spatial information. Spatial has come from space. Space means location. Location means latitude, longitude. So how this image is going to fit? For that, we do georeferencing. Because we have to refer it to the actual known location of the earth. For example, this is your house. This is your, say, school. This is your office. So you take the actual location and then you refer it to it. And when we take multiple location with using certain polynomial functions, formulas, we know how to solve a linear function and a binomial and a quadratic function. So then we have some error, so we just reduce that error. And finally, we are able to give location to every point. And this image can change its scenario, location, or say orientation. And finally, it finds its position to the actual location on the Earth after georeferencing. So this georeferencing is basically referring that or making this image suitable or say equipped to be on certain platform. Let me tell you again that this is what is the purpose of this georeferencing. As I said, you have a data which is having no information. It's just an image. So this image lies where it identifies to which place. This is our responsibility to give that location to this image. And the process of giving the location to this image is through georeferencing. It's a mathematical procedure. And we do it manually or automatically also. And now, finally, after georeferencing, that image has, or the photo has, all the information. So whenever we put it on a map or a globe, it goes to the exact location where that particular photo belongs. So more the points we take, more the location we take, which are known location, then we can refer it, or then when we do the computation processing, it gives information to all the pixels, and then it will be placed at the exact location. What is shapefile? Shapefile. So first of all, the name is saying that it is a file, like a data file, like a image file, like an MP3 file. So shape means different formation, geometric formations. So shape file, like as I said, the file means JPG, MP3, these are different formats. So this shape file is also a format. And this is generally we use in various geometry related, say software, GIS, and on map, on 3D. So whenever you see say road, or say a well and a house, so these are vectors, point, line, polygon. So this is a format, and we try to put this point, line, polygon as a map, because we are referring, we're showing the different aspects of Earth with certain figures. So this was made, shapefile is a format very popular, made by ESRI, Environmental System Research Institute. And this is a geospatial vector data for GIS softwares basically. And this is a very ideal format, and it became so popular. Now it has become the default shapefile for vector point line polygon representation, because these point line polygon can be represented in the form of shape files and the data attributes as well. So now you can employ this shape file format in various GIS software like MapInfo, ArcGIS, QGIS, and various others. So let me tell you about the details of these different files in the shape file. There is not a single file. It has multiple files. Some files are default also. Optional. You won't require it, but sometimes you may require it. So you need location, you need database, you need attribute, you need metadata information, you need optimization. For these, all these format was being made. So this is how a shapefile will look if you go to the famous software, which is ArcMap and ArcInfo. And these are the line, point line polygon. And these are different layers, and these layers can represent any point line polygon, can represent whole of the Earth. So these extensions of shapefile, what are the extensions of shapefile? So the normal file is .shp, and as I said, it was being developed by ESRI, very famous, or you can say the default, de facto software, this option file format for vector. So we have various software which are actually taking and employing this software. So SHP, we have different files here. As I said, the shape file will consist of various files, multiple combination of file, multiple files. So if you see here .shp, this is a mandatory ESRI file, and this gives feature, that is what, geometry. As I said, point line polygon, they are all geometry figures. So every shape file has its own SHP file that is going to represent the spatial vector data. Vector data means point line polygon, spatial means they have the geographic information also. So as I said, it can be point line polygon. Now you have SHX.SHX. So this is also a mandatory ESR. This has to be there. And this also has AutoCAD shape index position. So this type of file is used to search forward and backwards. So this is basically for searching. Because in your software or in your application, you're only always going to search. So it needs to have some searching information as well. So now we have DBF file, database file. So see, these are two P1, P2, say polygons, and what are the location, what is the area, what is the parameter. So this .dbf is a standard database file used to store attribute data and objects IDs. This is a mandatory file. And also you can open this easily in Microsoft Access or Excel. Now coming to PRJ, as I said, projection is very important because everywhere, every data comes with a projection. As I said, they are the GCS and PCS, geometric coordinate system and projected coordinate system. Then we have the various projection forms, GCS for globe, PCS for the map. And then we have the cylindrical, polyconic and azimuthal. These are different projections. The projections are basically from 3D to 2D conversion. So as I said, polyconic, this polyconic has cylindrical. We have different cylindrical also, transverse and oblique, they're different. So these are the projection. So this information, this is an optional file that contains the metadata associated with the shape file, coordinate system and the projection system. So if it is not existing, it will show unknown coordinate system. So you can just define the projection also if this unknown coordinate system comes. Okay. Now .xml, this file types contain the metadata associated with the shape file. So this is an XML, which is a data interchange de facto standard, as I said, on internet basically. .sbn and .sbx. So this two you see, .sbn and .sbx. So .sbn and .sbx, this is an optional spatial index file that will optimize the spatial queries. As I said, you'll always have queries. So this file type is saved together with this .sbx. SBN and SBX are there. And these both the files, SBN and SBX files, makes up a shape index in order to give the performance, that is to speed up the spatial queries. So this SBX is also similar to .sbn file, in which they speed up the loading times. So it worked with .sbn files to optimize the spatial queries. I hope you got the idea of .sbn and SBX. As I said, they are optional files, but they are specially for the information and the optimization of spatial queries. Then we have an optional plain text file also, .cpg. And this describes the encoding applied to create that shape file. As I said, it is an optional file you might not see in various shape files. What are GIS primitives? So primitives are the basic building blocks. So in GIS or in GIS primitives, we have point, line and polygon. In every map, in every say geometric representation, you can represent it by point, line or polygon. Because GIS is basically hardware, software and humanware, dataware, combination of this. So there is a complete, this is a complete system. GIS is a complete system, total system. So these are GIS primitives. Point, line, polygon. Okay. So let me show you what these GIS primitives are. They has. So points, these are the trees. You can show it by points. And these points are the vector layer. This is a vector layer. It will have the attribute also. That what is the height, what is the diameter, there are so many, these are just few I've showed you. Then we have lines. So if you want to show say some roads or this kind of features, say river, you can also use the lines here. So you can have different information here with depth, length like this. So these are the line feature. And then polygons, If you want to show your house, you want to show a big, say, water pond, water body, then you will use a polygon. Polygon is not always a regular polygon. It can be like this also. So you can use either point, line, polygon, depending upon what kind of map you are making, what kind of information you want to give. So you have to use GIS primitives. So this is how this GIS primitive work in various software. And you need to have a very broad idea about this point, line, polygon, because this is how actual map is being made. Cartographers are aware of that. What is pixel? Pixel is standing for picture element. So when you take an image and you just zoom it, and the last level you reach, you will see blocks, and these blocks are pixel. These are the basic picture element. So the smallest unit of information in an image or a raster map, these are image only, these are normally seen as square or rectangular. And this is also called a cell, picture element. So this is the smallest unit of a digital image. It will contain the digital number, brightness value. So you see here, this person is not walking. This cartoon is not walking. It is just that the different pixels are changing the color with time. And that is how it is showing the animation. So a pixel, again, a smallest unit of digital image or graphic, and that can be displayed and represented on a digital display device. It can be any kind of device, AMOLED, TFT, CRT, whichever you talk about. So this all have the picture element or pixel. So this is the basic logic unit in digital graphics, and these are combined to form complete image or a video or a text or any visible thing which can be viewed on any kind of computer display. So as I said, picture element has come from picture element, pix from picture, and EL is element. So in order to understand this pixel, just try zooming at image, that image or any image you have. Every photograph in its digital form is made up of pixels. As I said, they are very smallest. We are the last level, smallest unit of information that will make up an image or a text or say a video. They can be round, they can be square. Normally you will see a square and it will be arranged in a two-dimensional grid. The X and Y axis, you will see a two-dimensional grid. So this image, when it is magnified various times, so you will see the individual composition, and these are pixels, and this pixel approximate to the actual image. More pixels you have, more good image you have. The full HD, HD are basically more pixels you are showing in a particular area. What is overlay analysis? Overlay is all about showing one thing on another. So let me tell you a basic idea about this. Overlay is what? Say you are making sandwich. What you will do? You will take a bread. You will put some cucumber, some tomatoes, or coriander, and then you will put some chicken, mutton, burger, this slice or something, or cheese slice, and then put another this bread. So that is what you get as a overlay. So in a composite map, overlay is a GIS operation that superimposes multiple data set, and it can have different themes. Every map has a theme together for the purpose of identifying relationship between them. So it creates a composite map, different overlays, and it combines the geometry and also the attributes of all the overlaid input data sets. There are various, there's different people might have made different data, slope, stream buffers, land use, soils. So what all we want, what all we don't want, this also can be decided in an overlay. So these different layers, they are overlaid, and then we create a scene of a real world. A map has various combinations of this overlay, and that can be a map, and analysis can also be done. And this is specially used for various 2-3 themes that when they are combined, and a complete idea can be deciphered or can be taken out. What is attribute? For example, if you have a friend, what you will say? He is a very jovial, He's hardworking. He's very patient, playful. So this is how you say that, define a person, giving his or her attribute. So you will say, if somebody is coming, you will say, okay, there is a dark complexioned man. He is short-sighted. He is standing outside. Please tell him to come inside. But when you go outside, if you are not being told about attribute, how you are going to identify if there are multiple people? So non-special information about a geographic feature in a GIS, it is stored in the form of a table generally, and it is linked to a feature by some unique, say, identification. For example, you have a block here. We call it as a polygon. So these are numbered polygon. Now this polygon can be in some state. This can be in another state. Then we have latitude, longitude. So all these, a simple block you make, what all information it can carry, and this information add to the all information. It adds to the information. So these attributes are the basically metadata. So what are the types of attributes in GIS? As I said, attributes are the extra information or all the information of a geometric figure or feature in a GIS. So attribute, for example, and let me give an example. Have you seen any Indian state named as 007 or 786? No. You always see that there is a name always come. So you will say the state will be always character. So you will take a field, and when you define the database, you will say that only character we are going to enter, or say any number will come. In a box, you are making a box or a polygon sometime, or say point line polygon, any of the feature. You want to give that this is the ID. So this FID will always be integer. It cannot have a character. So every field will only contain certain type of data. On the basis of that, we decide the type. If this kind of area is there, this cannot be an integer. This is a fraction number, a decimal number. So we use floating type for that. If you have only, you want to give the date. So we have a special data type, which is the date. If you want to give some, say, BLOB, that is binary large object, then also it has a proper column or data type. These are the type of attributes in GIS, Geographical Information System. What is compression? Raster compression, image compression. Compression means to make it smaller, to squeeze it. Why do we do it? You are going to leave your country or to your friend. Now you want to carry a bag. That bag is having a capacity, limited capacity. Now you want to put everything there, whatever you have. So what do? You put everything and then you press your bag, then you chain it with all the pressure. So raster is a grid. It's a two-dimensional representation of the digital values or brightness values that corresponds to an image. So raster compression, the primary benefit of compressing your data is to reduce the size of the file to help save disk space. So a raster has certain information, and this information may be redundant also, repetitive also. So why not to use this redundancy or the repetitiveness and shorten it? So the added benefit is greatly improved performance over a network, because you are transferring a reduced amount of data. You are placing it into some disk and also transferring it. Because previously we were just keeping it in some hard drive or somewhere, pen drive. But now you're sending it also. So compression is helping you in many ways. First of all, you are compressing it, making it smaller. And then you're keeping it with lesser size. And then you are sending it on some network that has, say, smaller bandwidth. And then there is an added advantage also, that the application or software which is rendering it also is not putting so much effort to handle it, because if the data is large, it will have some problem. So data compression has various methods. There are two main methods: lossless method and lossy method. So for example, if you want to put pant, shirt, and say your shaving kit, So when you apply the lossless method in all these, you'll always get your pant, shirt, and this shaving kit. There will be no loss. There will be no loss. Run length encoding is simply when you have, say, some numbers repeated. For example, you have 75, 75, 75 every time coming. What you can do? Put 175 and then just put the frequency number. How many times this 75 is there? It is not always that it is 3. There are thousands of pixels, you know. So LZW, Lempel, Zipwelk, Huffman, run length, these are all lossless. But when you compress with lossy, pant, shirt, and shaving kit, you will lose either shirt or a pant. So the loss will be there. It is irreparable. A JPEG, MPEG, MP3. So this is a technique. Image compression is a technique where the size of the image is minimized by keeping the quality of the image to an acceptable level. You cannot just reduce that the image is not seen properly. The main idea or objective of this image compression is to decrease the redundancy of the image, which is always there in that image. And we can increase the capacity of the storage, and then in turn we get a very efficient transmission also. TIN. What is TIN? TIN. TIN stands for Triangular Irregular Network. Triangular Irregular Networks. So this is to represent surface morphology. So in GIS, this is for surface morphology, and these are a form of vector-based digital geographic data. And they're constructed by triangulating a set of vertices, points. So just understand, this is the real world. This is a terrain. Once you see, it looks good. But you need to show it on your computer system, analyze it. So in GIS softwares or related software, how to represent the actual terrain in different resolution, in different ways. There are certain undulation, there are trenches also. So we'll take the example or the difference with the grid also. But point line polygon. So TIN is a structure or network of polygon of triangles. These are triangles, and these triangles are made or are divided in a form that it represent the equal height scenario. There are small triangles, there are bigger triangles depending upon the variation of height or relief, and they are combined and they have different sizes. First they are triangles, then they have different sizes. So that is irregular, and since they are connected, this is network. So this is the basic form of the terrain being for which we make, and then we drape the image. We drape so that the actual real scenario is achieved. So here you see point, edge, and face. So this is a triangle. Now this, there are certain triangles we combine. So this is a point, this is called the edge, and these are called faces. So what do we achieve, and how do we make it? See, this is a tree. So now it's quite clear that this triangle or formation of triangle or network can show us a variation of height relief. So this TIN model is representing set of contiguous non-overlapping triangles. Each triangle is having a surface which is representing a plane, and triangles are made up of set of points which are called the mass points. So these mass points are having equal heights, that is a single triangle, and when the height is, say, variating, you have to make a lot of triangles. But if the height is not variating, you can achieve it by just making one triangle. So the more accurate model of the surface, we have well placed mass points, and when there is a major change in the shape of the surface, so if you see the peak of the mountain, floor of the valley, the edge, so there is some variation, you put more triangle. See, if a person is there, you want to make it in 3D, it will not be a face. First of all, you have to make a mesh, and that will be a triangular mesh or any other shape mesh, and then you drape his face. Similarly, for the real world scenario, we make triangles to represent the shape and undulations, and then we drape. So TIN model is very important, attractive because of its simplicity, and it has some good alternative, or it has given good alternative to the raster grid model. Raster is basically the rows and columns we know, and we have digital values, or if it is DM, then we have the height values. Say for example, this height is 5, this height is 10, some more height is 15. So these are the value. Now, in order to represent this, we can represent it using a triangle also. This is a grid form, and now I'm telling the triangle form. So in order to represent the same thing, it can be a grid form with height values, or it can be triangle. And these triangles, one triangle will have the almost equal height. So these are the points being taken, and these points decide which point or which area is higher than the MSL, mean sea level, and which is lower, or which is at higher height and lower height. Then we try combining these points using the triangle. These are points, then we join them using the edges, and then it makes a triangle. And then we finally give the height values or the triangular height values, and then it makes a proper terrain. So there are certain comparison with the grid. So TIM, there are certain advantages of TIM. This has the ability to describe the surface at different level of resolution, and it is very efficient to store data with as against the grid value. And the grid also has some advantages. That is, grid can be, the data can be easily stored and manipulated, and the raster databases which are available, grid can be easily say integrated with this, and it is quite smoother in appearance. TIM is not that smooth. We can make it smooth with lesser triangle, but if we have coarse triangle, if we have a smaller number of triangle, then it will be coarse. But the disadvantage of TIM is, in many cases, it requires visual inspection, a manual intervention and manual control of the network. And in grid, the advantage is it has the inability to use various grid sizes, because there are different areas, different complexity, different relief, different aspect. So for that, grid may not be that much helpful. What is topology? Topology. Say, if this is your house. This is your house. Now, who is on the right side of your house? Who's your neighbor? You are Sharmaji, he is Varmaji. On left, your Gupta ji is living. And your back neighbor is Aleem Sahab. And you have a road here. So topology is just this thing. This is arrangement of how this point line polygon, that is the feature of the vector files or vectors or the real world, they share geometry. How they share geometry. Because every world, every thing can be represented by either point or line or polygon. So the topology is all about the relationship between this geometry, these figures in the layers. I'll tell you the more wide definition of this. But before this, let me tell you that these geometry figures, for example, points, for example, lines, for example, polygons, these points, which point is related to which point, or which point is related to, say, three points. So the point has certain value, that is the x and y coordinate with reference to some coordinate system. Similarly, we have a line. So what is the beginning node? What is the end node? Which is the polygon to the left, which is the polygon to the right. So these polygons, they have different lines, which lines are combining. So after A, which is coming the B, or if A polygon is connected to which all polygons, this is the topology. Let me tell you the types of topology. The arc node topology, these are the line features that can share endpoints. These are the endpoints. So this is called arc node topology. Then we have polygon topology. The area features, polygon features can also share boundaries. Then this is root or route topology. The line features can share segments with other line feature, that is a small segment. Then area features can overlap with other area features. This is called the region topology. One is over the other, overlapping. And then node topology. Line feature can share endpoint vertices with point features. That is the line and point features. I'm talking about two different features, and they are sharing some vertices. Point events. So point features can share vertices with the line features. So point with line. Line feature sharing with vertices and point feature sharing with line. So these are node topology and point features. So these are the different types of topology. So this is basically the arrangement of how these features share geometry. So whenever we talk about GIS and this kind of technology, spatial means has come from space. Space means location. Location means latitude, longitude, or the meters definition. So when we talk about ology, so that is we are studying something, topology. So here what we are doing in topology, we are talking about the study of geometrical properties and the spatial relationship between the which are the parts of the shape or the related shape. For example, if I make this, you will tell it is a rectangle. If I make this, same rectangle will be changed to rhombus. The geometric properties have been changed. So if the relationship between the lines are changed, say I make the diagonal intersect at 90 degree, it will become a rhombus. So this topology, it considers everything from individual feature to the relationship between these feature point line polygon. And individual feature can be point line polygon, and this polygon can be further divided into nodes, vertices, segment, edges, faces. So the topology actual definition is the science and mathematics of relationship used to validate the geometry of vector entities and for operations such as network tracing and tests of polygon adjacency. So if I just make a polygon and if I want to check, so which is side of the A, it will be B, but we found it to be C. So this is how we check the topology. Now you see, we start with a point. This is just a 2D points. Now we combine these points with some edges. And when we combine these points or edges, we found the faces. So we got a proper figure. Now this figure has certain back relationship with the basic features. And these features they are combined to form a proper geometric figure. So this is called the topology, and topology is not only one figure, it is the combination of figures. What is terrain? Terrain. So a terrain is a data set. Normally we call it when we see something of the earth surface. We want to show the undulation. We want to show the height and the low parts, that is the ridges and troughs. So this is a multi-resolution tin-based surface. Tin is basically a triangular irregular network. And this tin-based surface is built from measurements stored as features in a geo database. Basically, you can call it as a database. So this is not made by just one data. It can be lidar, sonar, photogrammetric sources. And finally, we decide the geography or the undulation or the view, how this terrain will look or this area will look. So this has basically the feature, and these features construct a view that will be a terrain. For example, we have these triangles. When we combine these triangles of almost equals say face or height, it becomes a base for the draping. So terrain is to relate with relief. It's not actually height or altitude. It's a relief how the height changes. So this is actually the third vertical dimension of land surface. So for everything, for every land surface, basically it's a 3D surface. So height varies. When we describe inside water, this becomes bathymetry. So this is topography, how the real world will look and how to show this real world in originality with the description and meaning of those places. So this terrain is generally we use for in terms of physical geography and many sciences. So we are showing the lie of the land. For example, we have elevation angle. This is the slope, rate of change of height, and the aspects. So this terrain effects or terrain is used mainly for flow of water, weather, climate pattern, in hydrology, in forestry, various places. So this is terrain. So terrain has consisting of various things, just not one thing. So terrain is actually showing the real world scenario. What is KML? KML. KML stands for Keyhole Markup Language. So this is an XML based format for storing geographical data and associated or attribute or content. Once this has become the Open Geospatial Consortium standard, This is now a common format for sharing the geographic data among softwares. So this has all the information, and this is a vector data kind of thing. And various operations, various applications deals with it. So this is a standard now. The key whole markup language, KML, is essentially a shapefile only. And this is now XML based. So you want to share data, you want to say send data, and you want to show the data. Data means point line polygon features, all these on internet, on internet based application. For this, we needed some different kind of say data, not the shape files. So we got KML and this KMZ. So KML is a single file, KMZ is a compressed file. So these are basically the shape files. So this is a globe, if you see, and over this we are showing shape. And even you can see the 3D version of these shapes. These are basically polygons, points only. So KML is an XML notation in order to express the geographic annotation. And you can show it on 2D maps and 3D maps, browsers, and application. So KML was developed for using it with Google Earth, and which was originally named as Keyhole Earth Viewer. And since it was developed by a company called Keyhole, which was actually acquired by Google in 2004. So this KML, Keyhole Markup Language, has become the international standard from 2008, because OGC made this standard. So this, there are various programs. Google Earth was the first one where these KML files can be edited. And then we have Marble and all those applications now have this KML support. So these are these shapes, polygon, point, line, and that can be shown in various applications, especially the internet and the browser. KML, KMZ, these are the file extension you will form. What is geoprocessing? Whenever you encounter with the word geo, that means we are talking about Earth, our planet Earth. Processing means you will give some input. There will be mathematical computation, programming computation, everything will be done, and then you'll get some output. This is processing. So processing for Earth or whatever features are there on Earth, this is called as geoprocessing. So these are various combination of tools, and this combines the simple buffer way, polygon overlay. It can go up to regression analysis, image classification. So input data set, when we do geoprocessing, we get some output data set. For example, you have a data which is unprojected. It is not projected. You don't have a projection information because you need projection to show it in the any kind of software or application. Now we applied this tool, that is geoprocessing tool, which is called the projection say tool. And now the data has become projected data. So the process contained tool, and the tool has parameters. It's all about making the data meaningful. So this is the processing of geographic information. That is why we are calling it as geoprocessing. And it performs various functions, spatial analysis, modeling, because we have different functions which are already being programmed as tools, and it will transform the data set. So now see here, I'll give you an example. So we have a map. We select a school. That is, we selected a layer by its attribute or its property. Now we defined an area where the billboards or the signboards are not allowed. So we created a buffer zone, that this school, around this school, this area is not allowed for billboard. For example, in a near a hospital, there's a zone where you cannot horn or honk. Okay, when we combine this buffer with this layer attribute, the output came. So we found the parcels or area which are affected by the new regulation, that these areas, these parcels are not billboards are not allowed. So this is an intersection operation. So the buffering, intersection, selection of attribute, this is all geoprocessing. Finally, we got a result. So geoprocessing has various functions. This is not a one function, combination of function. That is, two layers, two overlays can be combined to form the union of them, both of them, intersection which is common of them, identity, that is whichever identity you take, that will come. And you have a clipping feature combined and just clip that area, that is the circular area we want to cut out of some area. Then we can dissolve, that is multiple parts can be dissolved in one, merged, they can be merged, and the buffer zone which I just showed. So these are the geoprocessing. Concept is, explain geoid. So wherever a geo word will come, that means we are going to talk about earth. So this is the surface of earth. What all we have seen up till now, sometimes earth is shown as a sphere or an ellipse just for some mathematical computation. But the geoid is the equipotential surface of the earth's gravity field, which best fits in the least square sense global mean sea level. That is, the earth is under gravitational pull. We have moon, we have sun, we are a system of planet. So all the water bodies, mainly the sea and oceans, which are connected. So we need to approximate the earth using this mean sea level, because the height, the elevation, it is not equal. Somewhere it is very high, somewhere it is very low. So you see here, this is the ocean, say, equipotential surface, and this is the surface using the oceans. Wherever water is there, please understand that water will always settle, that is, it will come from always flow from the higher altitude to the lower altitude. So geoid is defined as the surface of the earth's gravity field, and that is approximately same as the mean sea level. So you need to keep in your mind whenever you are talking about geoid or mean sea level. Okay, so we have to compute some location identification. For that we try to make a figure which fits the earth. For that we use some ellipsoid and spheroid, but actually the earth is a geoid, not a regular surface. So the mean sea level at a particular location on the earth, if you just extend it to all the direction, entire earth, so you will get, or you will form a spheroid which is not actual spheroid but undulated, different height, different form spheroid, that is called geoid. So geoid is actual shape of the earth that the surface of the ocean would take under the influence of this earth gravity and rotation alone. We are not talking about the winds and tides, because that is the other influence. This geoidal surface is also called as equipotential gravity surface. That is why we are taking this ocean surface, which is the mean sea level, as the surface which is extended to the earth also, and that is called the geoid. Explain spheroid. So this spheroid, we always talk when we are talking about in GS, the projection and the shape of the earth, we always talk about the ellipsoid and spheroid, because the circle or the sphere, the radius is common, but in an ellipse, the semi-major axis and semi-minor axis is there, the radius is not equal everywhere. So this 3D surface, this 2D ellipse, if you just move it round, then it forms a 3D structure which is ellipsoid, also known as spheroid. So this is basically an ellipsoid created from ellipse. So now we have a major axis and a minor axis here. And since we got it by rotating the ellipse, the shape of the rotated figure is a spheroid. As I said, Earth has an irregular shape. This is the actual shape of the Earth. So the best way to mathematically and geometrically form it in order to do all the computation, finally we have called it as oblated spheroid. Earth shape is oblated spheroid. Now we have the semi-major axis and semi-minor axis. These are the numbers. Then we can do the computation. What is a datum? So whenever you say your friend, you have to come to my house and this is the route you have to take. So you will tell him the starting point, the initial point, that is called the reference point. So in order to have mathematical computation and finding out the location and modeling the Earth, we need to have a basis or the reference, that is called the datum. So this datum is built on top of the selected spheroid, and this should incorporate the local variations in elevation. So Earth is not a sphere, not an ellipse. So it's basically a geoid. Geoid is undulated surface formed by the geopotential equality of the mean sea level extended to the Earth. Okay, so the spheroid, you see two lines here. The actual surface is this red one. So it's very undulated, it's not smooth. So we need to encapsulate Earth in certain kind of 3D geometry figure so that we can model it and try to compute the different parameters which are required. So this spheroid, the rotation of the ellipse creates a totally smooth surface across the world, which is not actually the Earth, which is different. Now, because this doesn't reflect reality very well, because reality is different, as I said, a local datum has to be there in order to incorporate the local variations in elevation. That is, the whole Earth has a different datum, but that datum has only been formed by taking the local elevation, local area into consideration. Because somewhere it is water, somewhere it is mountain. So when we take a ellipsoid or a spheroid that fits the Earth to a larger extent, and then we take the local variations in elevation, this also we incorporate, then we call it as the actual modeling or the datum. And that datum is basically a figure. I'll show you the example. These are two datums, 1927 and 1983. So we took a spheroid. Now this spheroid is covering this area or modeling this area very well. How about these area? These are not being taken care. For that, we ought to have, this is mandatory, that we take this NAD 1983 so that we cover other areas which are not covered in 1927. So these are the local incorporation of the elevation, and then we call it as a whole datum, like World Geodetic System 1984. So you see this GPS also, UTM and WGS 1984 it takes. So let me tell you again, datum is a reference, and which is the actual spheroid in which the Earth is being modeled, taking the local variation into consideration. So there are two things. One is the global mean sea level, then we have the spheroid, and there is a difference that has to be incorporated. What is local datum? Explain local datum. So local datum aligns its spheroid to closely fit the Earth's surface in a particular area, because Earth is like this. So this Earth, if we want to put it in the ellipse, somewhere it fits very good, somewhere it doesn't fit, because Earth is very undulated. So a point on the surface of the spheroid is matched to a particular position on the surface of the Earth. So this point is known as the origin point of the datum. The blue line is the actual Earth, which is the geoid. The red line is the global datum, which is fitting whole of the Earth, like WGS 84, which suits or best fit the globe globally. And then we have the local datum. This best fits on a local area. That is the local area it is covering. So the coordinates of the origin are fixed, and all other points are calculated from this point. So we cannot only have a single spheroid, oblate spheroid to represent the Earth, because we need the local datum also. Everywhere the Earth is different. So you cannot just say that American, the undulations are same as the African. That is why we need local datum also, and these local datum are incorporated, and then a final global datum is being made. So this is the actual scenario. Earth is undulated, it is not a sphere, not an ellipse. We need a local datum. What is projected coordinate system, or PCS? The Earth, as I said, assume it to be a globe. Earth can be represented by a sphere, by an ellipse. Basically, we take it as oblate spheroid. But this globe, you cannot take it everywhere. You can show it on a 3D software. But if you want to take it somewhere or to understand your area, then you need to have it in a 2D map or two-dimensional scenario. So this 2D is the projected coordinate system. So from 3D, which is the GCS, that is global coordinate system, or the 3D surface, when it is projected to a 2D, then it is called PCS, project coordinate system. Because in this projected coordinate system, we just have the X and Y axis. In GCS, we have X, Y and Z, three axes. So in this projected, in GCS, a projected coordinate system has, unlike this GCS, in PCS, we have constant length, angle, areas across these two dimensions, X and Y. So always understand, PCS will always be based on some GCS, which is the geographic coordinate system, which is actually the, you know, equator, prime meridian, latitude, longitude, and that is based on a sphere or a spheroid. So if you take the Earth, let me show you here. You are taking the Earth and now you placed it inside an imaginary cylinder. Now this cylinder is, we are trying to best fit it. Then we put a light inside this sphere, imaginary light. So whatever imaginary line we have decided in GCS, like the parallels and the meridians and the all equator, etc. Now when this light comes out of this sphere, the particular point, how that point is projected onto that cylinder. That cylinder. Now we, these all project points are projected on the cylinder. Then we cut this cylinder and open it. So it will be a 2D. So that points which are being projected are shown in this cylinder form, or in whatever this projection coordinate system. See area, the shapes and the distance. You cannot save everything. Some you have to say compensate. What are the projection types? So we have mainly conic, cylindrical and planar. Planar is also called as orthographic, azimuthal. So if you assume Earth as a globe or a sphere or a spheroid, ellipsoid, then you put a light source inside the Earth. This is all imaginary. Then you try to keep it inside a figure, which can be a cylinder, which can be a conical, which can be a planar. So these points, when this light inside will project this light, this point on the globe to this developable surface, which is a cylinder here. So now this cylinder will have all the points, and when we open it, that is the projection. Cylinder, in this cylinder, this area from here to here, it will be covered very, very efficiently. All this area will be projected very nicely. But what about the above area? This area also we have to cover. For that conical projection have come. So it can be perspective conic, the cones can be in oblique form, different form. Now this area is now projected with a light source inside. And then people told, what about the North Pole and South Pole? For that, planar has come. So these all projections have come in order to project the different parts of the world, the different parts of the globe. The just imagine there is a light, and when this light is lit, the globe, the parallels and meridians, the points on the Earth, when they are projected to the developable surface, that developable surface is called the projection or PCS. So the three principal cartographic criteria of map projection is, some are saving the shape, some are saving the distance, some are saving the areas. That is, there are various number of projection. Some may be conformal, some may be equidistant, some may be equivalent. All of them will not save everything. You have to compromise some or the other thing. If you want good shape, the distance and area will not be preserved. If you want actual area, which is on the globe, should also be on the 2D, that is the 2D map. You cannot have the shapes. So we have UTM and the Google Maps, Bing, and this Marble, they are using WMP, that is Web Mercator Projection. So these are also popular kind of projections, and mostly they show the Earth quite properly. What is GCS, or Geographic Coordinate System? So Earth, we can assume it to be a globe, sphere, spheroid, ellipsoid. So the main thing is that we need to find a location. We need to find the length between two points. So there need to be certain computation. So when we were kids, so we learned that to locate a point, we have a Cartesian coordinate system. So for that, we have x-axis, horizontal, then we have y-axis. So any point location can be found out or it can be located. Now we have to model the Earth. So this is a 3D figure. This is a 3D geoid basically. So how do we find out the location? Because on the X, Y plane, you can find out X, 2, Y, 5 like this. So how do we do this? The Earth is assumed to be a spheroid, oblate spheroid. And then there is, first see that there is no line here. These are all imaginary. So we try to divide the Earth into two equal parts. And this line, or to be very precise, to be a circle. It goes round on the backside also. So this is this line is called equator, and this is a circle, and that circle forming a plane is equatorial plane. So this we assume to be the x-axis. The upper part is called north hemisphere. The lower part is called southern hemisphere. X-axis is done. Now coming to y-axis. So we divided the Earth again into vertical two parts. So this is the vertical two parts. We called it as prime meridian. So now this prime meridian, you can assume this is also a circle. So it's a plane. It is also a plane. And this line is actually passing through Greenwich, place in UK. Okay. So in order to locate a point, we got the origin. So we need the, say, steps also 1, 2, 3 like this in a Cartesian coordinate system. So we made these parallels, the lines on the plane which are parallel to the equatorial plane. These were called parallels. And then so exact location only we got when we have the y respective line also. This. So these were called as longitude or meridians. Longitudes and meridians. Now when we have the x-axis parallel and y-axis meridian, now we can identify a point exactly. So this latitude, longitude are angles. For example, we want the location of this point. So this line joining the center to that point or the surface is making some angle with the equatorial plane. That is called the latitude. Now coming here, take the center of the Earth and take any point on the globe. So the angle of this center from center to this point, which it is making with the vertical plane, is called as the longitude. So latitude, longitudes are angles. So now we got the parallels, meridians, and now the angles, which are latitude, longitude. So this is corresponding to, you can say, x and y axis. So we made a system. This includes angular unit of measure, latitude, longitude, prime meridian, and a datum. Datum, because you have to specify which spheroid, which ellipsoid you are taking. So in a GCS, a point is referenced by its lat, lon, or latitude, longitude. Basically, it was for identifying a position and then computation thereafter. So this latitude and longitude, see, latitude goes from 0 to 90 to the north and 0 to 90 to the south. There is no negative. Now meridian, I'm talking about longitude. So longitude starts, so this is a Greenwich, this is the prime meridian. So from this point to the right side, that is the eastward, it goes back. This is 180 degree. This is 180 degree east. This is the eastern part. And then on the left side, it is west. It also goes from 0 to 180 degree. So in all, it is 360 degree. Is GIS a map? The answer is no. It is a part of a GIS. So in a GIS or geographic information system, it consists of hardware, software, dataware, and humanware. That is, this is a total combination. This is a management system. This is an information system. It includes tools. It includes processing. It includes the hardware providing the processing. It includes software. So the map comes under data. Map, or we have the, you know, chloroplast map, and there are so many thematic map. So this maps are only the part of a GIS. Map is very important because without data, there is no use of GIS. So this map will show from here to here, what is the distance, what is the 20 kilometer range, where you have hospitals, So it's a part. Map is a part of GIS. GIS is a system and services that help us to store, analyze, process, and share geolocated data or spatial and also non-spatial data. It contains map, or better, can create maps. What are major GIS functions? GIS has immense functions. So majority of GIS function, as I say, GIS has the hardware on which the software is going to work. The software, because it has to be a high-end system. Software can be ArcGIS, it can be Quantum GIS, it can be ILVIS, GRASS. And now we need to have data, because data is more important. It can be point line polygon, we call it as vector data. It can be a raster data, which we call it a satellite image, etc. Annotation data. So these human are also involved, because human are going to work on this, analyze, etc. So data is the key. But the major function is, first we have to acquire the data. That is, it can be a spatial data having all the information, geographic information, or it can be non-spatial data having no information at all. First is to capture the data. Then we have to process the data. First we have to acquire, then we need to store it somewhere. So once it is stored properly, acquire, store. Now the data is available. It's basically storing, I'm saying the efficient storing and retrieval. Now the data is available. We have various options. There is various process, various algorithms, various code. So now we can find out that what all is, or how many hospitals are nearby, or what is the 100 decibel sound which is coming or which is not allowed in this buffer zone. So this is now we have provided the query, and then we analyze that which area we should say or parcels, or say we want that this not to be there in vicinity of hospitals. So whatever result we got, now we have to display it. So data analysis, it can be spatial and statistical analysis. Then again, we need to store it. Again, I'm saying that storage should be efficient. And finally, whatever display or output we get, we have to present it in the form of maps, graphs, tables, and reports. We need to be able to store this data and export it as well. So basically, as I said, data is the key. Everything goes around it. Hardware, dataware, humanware. Basically, data is there, but the major GIS function include right from the getting the data till the saving the data and sending the data in a meaningful form. What are the main processes that can be applied on vector data? Vector data corresponds to point line polygon. In geometry, we have learned about what is point line polygon. So this point line polygon comprises of this vector data. Anything which you want to represent, it can be either represented by any of these three. Because if you want to show, say a river, okay, this river can be shown by a line also. It can be shown by a polygon also. So there are multiple processes that can be employed on this point line polygon vector data, and this is all the process of processing and analysis. So we take, say, vector 1, vector 2, two layers. Now when we try to geoprocess them, when we try to apply the processing on this, we get a resultant data. For example, these are two sets. If we want intersection, this area we are going to take out. If you want to take the union, then this whole portion you are going to take. You want to clip, say, V2 out of V1, so this portion will come. If you want to take out V1 from this V2, then you have to take this figure will be final. So clipping, union, intersection, reprojection, dissolution, all these are there. Merging also. So let me just discuss them. Union. So this is one vector data, this is second vector data. Or the second vector data can also be a layer. So when we combine that, total of them. Intersect means only which is common between them. This is the only common portion. Symmetrical difference means combine them and take out the common portion, which is the intersection portion has to be taken out. This is symmetrical difference. How about identity? Take two vector, whichever vector you want. Means combine them and just take out the vector or show that vector which is what is required. Means identity is only what is required. V1 maybe V2. Clip layer, this is a clip layer. Put it on the input layer and then you get the output layer. That only part will be shown. Erase is means put this erase layer and that particle will be taken off. You can split also, means a layer can be split into multiple parts. You can have a split layer. You can also dissolve it, means layers can be dissolved, layer can be merged on the basis of the different geoprocessing activity which we perform on different layers, vector layers. So these are just few of them I told you, but there are so many. If you go to GIS operating system, GIS information system. What is ArcGIS? ArcGIS is the worldwide famous, mostly used software developed by ESRI. And this software was basically the basic building block of all the software which we see today. This is a proprietary software. This is not open. This is not free. So this ArcGIS is a GIS for working with the maps and geographic information. So it works with the raster data. It works with the vector data, annotation, etc. So this is used to create maps, to compile geographic data. This geographic data comes in different form. And also we analyze the information. Then we take the meaningful output. Then we share and discover the geographic information. And using map and geographic information in various applications. Also, we can manage this data in the form of a database. Database like the SQL and all these we have. This has its own database. Database that is a kind of geo database and meta database. There are so many. So this is an information system containing all the database activity along with the processing activity and various raster and data, image showing and analysis and exporting. What is open source software? Open source software. First is open, means it is open for all. Source means the source code. Whenever we make a software, it is made or it is written in some code. Visual C++, Java, NetBeans. So you use programming language C, C++, Java, C Sharp, Python. So there are so many languages in which a software can be coded or some web program. So when you made a software, this software can be sold or this software can be given for free. Open source software are those software which are open and available for free. So open source application is software that you can freely access and you can also modify the source code because the source code is available for us. So there are so many licenses under which this open source software are there in the market on the internet, GNU license, etc. When coming to GIS software, we have various open source GIS software, QGIS, GVSIG, Saga, CRAS, Mapindo, Ilves, UDIG, OpenJump. ArcGIS is a proprietary software, though this is the best software available, but this is proprietary. So in order to use this, you have to buy it. But other software which are developed by different developers or different companies, they have tried to provide all the functionalities and especially for certain purposes. For a hydrologist, certain software may be better, or maybe for some geologist, certain other software may be better. Basic thing is, these are the software available and now you can change the code if you want to put your functionality, add functionality, you want to develop it for university and reproduce it. This is the option. Okay, this is all about this GIS question answers. Thank you so much. Take care of yourself.